My heart is full, Lord. It's been a beautiful 2 days, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love. Thank you, Lord, for your ministry in us, and for us, and for others. Thank you to show us how blessed we are when we go and touch lives of people in your name, Lord. We ask you, Lord, that the encouragement of the power of the Holy Spirit in us will continue, and not to give up when the hard situations come along. You say in your word that we can do all things through you, not in us, but through you, Lord. And we pray not only for the few that we are here tonight, but we pray for all the congregation, Lord. We pray that everyone that it belongs to the membership of this Somebody Foursquare Church be blessed. Those who are resting, those who are maybe busy right now, whatever, Lord, bless them. Touch their hearts and the minds and the bodies of those who need to be touched. And Lord, we are here to meditate in your word and light us to your Holy Spirit. We don't need to expose the word, Lord, for we depend upon you and everything. But to receive it, Lord. Remind us, Lord. Remind us how much we need you. Remind us that you always be there, Lord. We thank you once again, Lord. We give you honor and glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In the last 2 months, has been very rewarding for me. To feel that you belong is a very, very important thing in life. God didn't make men to be alone. That was another plan of God. God wanted for us to live in a way that we had communion one with another, that we help one another, that we help in such a way that we all survive. The principle of the body of Christ is so important for us to learn in a way that we get a real sense that we belong the body. There are two epistles in the New Testament that talk about this in a very systematic and profound way. One is the epistle of the Ephesians, and the other one is the epistle of Philippians. Paul knew and tried to encourage the churches that he founded. And in his teachings to those churches always encouraged the people to realize and to learn that they were a body. They were the body of Christ. And the principle that Jesus is the head of the body is he always tried to reinforce that constantly. And it's very important. Maybe we lose because of the repetitious thing, especially when we are in church. We might get accustomed to hear certain things that we kind of lose the real meaning of things. But the concept of being a member of something is of tremendous importance because it develops in you a sense of rest because you know that you are not alone. And to me, at least, that is very important. To know that I have somebody that understands or that isn't this trying to do more or less the same that I'm trying to do. And It also encouraged me to learn to do my part. Now, the part that I'm going to make, do in that body that the Lord puts me, is not predicated in my wisdom, is not predicated in my power, is everything is generated by God. And it is important that we understand that. Let me read a couple of verses here. I promise you that I'll send you home early. By 8 o'clock we'll be out. No, I don't think Brother Jesse will be happy about that. But anyway, in Philippians, in the book of Philippians, chapter 2, the Apostle Paul says to that church in verse 1 of the second chapter, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, and then in verse 2 he adds, then make my joy complete by being like-minded. Having the same love, being of one spirit and one mind. You people, I mean, you people, that's not Santa, that's not okay. We, the society, is in such a way, men and women are in such a way that you can be in a meeting with 1,000 people and you feel alone. I don't know if that ever happened to you. You can be talking to people be talking to you and trying to say, and you are thinking in something else. You are listening to the words, but your mind is in your heart is somewhere else. There are principles in this that it is important for, at least for me, to learn and to really apply in my life, because I know the carnals have certain tendencies. And the tendency that I have is to be alone. I like to be alone. But that's not what I need, see? What I like is not what I need. I need to be with members of the body of Christ. It's very dangerous for a person like me to withdraw and to be put myself in the corner, and because it's very dangerous, but it's very, I have that tendency. All my life I have that tendency, and I know that. Somebody in a church told me, says, you always are here, but you are not here. And he noticed that, and I said, sometimes you're right. He said, sometimes I'm here, but I'm not here. And he says, and he was an old minister, and he says, be careful, Carlos. And I really appreciated that he mentioned that to me. Because right from the beginning of the creation of God, God made in the sons of Adam and Eve, God, when Cain and Abel were, they had the problem that they had, and then finally we all know the story that Cain kills Abel. And then the Lord asked the question, where is your brother? Now God, of course, he knew what happened. But he wanted to, this is the beautiful thing about God, you know, that he knew that Cain had killed his brother. And however, he doesn't come accusing, he comes and say to him, where is your brother? And the reaction of this man was, I don't mind, I really don't care for a person, I really don't care whatever. what is this? You know, am I my brother's keeper? And that sense of independence that the heart of men sometimes get, to make yourself different, to make yourself and create yourself in such a way that you develop an attitude that I don't need anybody type of thing. It is very, very dangerous for a person that belongs to the body of Christ. I'm repeating to myself quite a bit, but I wanted to emphasize that. I wanted to emphasize, because I have noticed, and I don't say this in critic, I'm saying that I have noticed here in the church, there are members that they have fear of become part of it. I'm not accusing them, I'm not criticizing them. I'm just saying that they haven't realized that unless you allow God to include you, you're going to have a very hard time growing spiritually. Unless you allow God to do what He's supposed to do, what I'm supposed to realize that I belong to the body of Christ, and that David is one member of the body, and God gave David some gifts that I don't have. However, I need these gifts to continue my growth. Like, by the same token, I might have some gift that he doesn't have, and vice versa, you know. I had a conversation with somebody not too long ago, and this person was trying to tell me about things, and I said, listen, I'm an old man. And in a way, it's kind of hard to be old, because all the pains and aches. But it's beautiful because you learn a lot of things that you don't realize when I was your age. And he said, what is that? And I said, nobody is indispensable. He said, what do you mean? I said, yeah, you can leave and we'll be sorry because we love you. But don't get in the idea that you are punishing us. Because that is not going to happen. See, well, yeah, but no, I said, listen, I'm telling you this with love. Nobody is indispensable. And I have learned that, you see, through the years, that we survive somehow. God makes us that gives the ability to survive. But Paul keeps saying to this in this chapter 2 of the book of Philippians, it says in verse 3, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, rather in humility value others above you, or putting others above yourself. Now when you read that verse, probably we can stay all night in that verse. Because what Paul is trying to say to this church is, you have to learn to deny yourself. When you read the verse, do nothing of our selfish ambition. That means that you have to deny yourself. Because what I'm going to do, what God is going to ask me to do, is for the benefit of others. That's the function of the body of Christ. I couldn't do what we did yesterday by myself. It's so obvious, right? I needed Sister Rochelle to cook, and because she's got that gift, I needed somebody else to do this. We needed each other. And sometimes, like I saw yesterday, it was kind of funny. I see that we didn't prepare the proper way to be what I'm doing. It was beautiful, but still we didn't do it quite there. However, I went home walking in the air. And I said, that was a good thing. That was not only a good thing, it was a beautiful thing. I was talking, Sister, Manila, and the other one is Sister
Ben.
Ben. She was talking, in my car, you know, and I look at her and say, this is the same girl that I know, because she's been so quiet lately. And yesterday, you could see in her face this blur, you know, and she said to me, there's one, and she almost jumped out of the car, you know, and run in the back, you know, to get the food, you know. And I was looking at her and said, God bless you. This for that was worth it. To see this girl that has been going through a hard time with her health. And I don't know, I think that she had a hard life in a way. But I for a moment in life, she forgot about everything and she went and tried to help. And it was beautiful. Paul saying this here that do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain. Conceive rather than humility, value others about yourself. One thing that I learned is to learn to listen. I don't know everything, and I never will. I never will be able to learn everything that God, you know, that other people know some things and I know some others, but what I'm trying to say is that I have to try to use my time in the best way that I can, in such a way that I can be benefited by that, and at the same time, I be of the most value to that body. Sometimes I have to deny myself some things that I would like to do because of the purpose of that I know that I have a duty here. Now, nobody's putting a gun on me to do it. But I know that God has been so kind to me, and it is good for me to do things. So then Paul adds in the following verse, don't be looking for your own interests. See this little passage in chapter 2, 1 to 11, these are beautiful passages. I recommend to anybody to read it and to study it. Because it really kind of puts you in line again. To remind yourself why I'm here in the Somebody Foursquare Church. I have learned that life is made out of cycles. Look around you, and you look at your life, and you will look back, and you will see some cycles in your life. You will see the cycle of your childhood, your life with the time when you were in the adolescent, and the time when you became a young man or a young lady, and you see how different you used to think, how different you used to behave in those different parts of your life. And at the end, you learn to sit and wait. But then you see the nature, and you see the cycles of the nature. There's winter, there's autumn, there is summer, and we're back, but it's okay. And then it's the spring. And every one of the stations of nature has a purpose. And the purpose is that it's always being renewed. Always being renewed. Spring is a time when flowers come alive and birds are singing. And then summer gets a little bit uncomfortable, but it's the time to get the fruit from the trees. It's the time when the farmers and people that have farms, you know, are really busy getting the fruit. And then autumn is a time when you start the new thing. And you see the nature changing colors. I mean, it is so beautiful. I don't know, maybe I'm really at all. But the thing is, you know, that, and then again, you know, it's always that process of renewing. Animals know that. Animals know how to behave in the different stations by instinct. Now, I'm not comparing myself to an animal, but What I'm trying to say is that God made us in such a way that we have to learn to behave as we continue walking. So this is where I want to go. Then I come to this station of my life. And I look back and I say, wow, I really made a mess of that, those stations back there. And then this voice to come and say, come to me, Carlos, if you are tired, if you are defeated, come to me, Carlos. I am the way. You can walk now in the next dimension of your life, in the next time thing in your life, and I'm going to walk with you, and I'm going to teach you how to walk. I have the tendency as a human being, you know, to say, no, wait a minute, I know how to walk. And he has been so kind to me that he says, yes, I know something, you know how to walk. And you walk through disasters always. You always crash cars. I wanted to teach you to walk in a way that you be a you're going to develop the purpose of which you were created for. Now please listen 1 second. You know, I'm not the most brilliant guy in the world or anything. No, I don't even think about it. What I'm trying to say is this. I love to be meditating in the Word of God. To me, that's essential. Not because I want to be better than anybody, no. It's because I need it. I need it because I know that in a very quick way I can make a mess of things. I know that for myself. I might make a snap decision, you know, and really make a real trouble. But then this voice came and this being, this God, this spirit, says, I wanted to share something that you cannot produce, Carlos. And it is necessary for you to walk in this thing that I call the body of Christ. Going back to what I just learned. The things that Paul is asking me to do, to asking us even today, we cannot do it without the presence of love in our lives. You can read it and read it again and you say, yeah, I can do this. For example, it says in verse, verse 4, not looking for your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. I don't know about you. When I was out there, you know, in society without God, yes, move over, buddy, because I'm coming. And I really don't care much about your interests. I just want to get mine my way. And you just sit there and wait if you want to, you know. But then you come here to the body of Christ. And before I do anything, I'm supposed to stop and think about what I'm going to do. It's predicated in the benefit of others. Not for, oh, he's wonderful. That has nothing to do with that. It has to do with the fact that everything that God is teaching me how to do is benefit others. Not only my family, not only my sons, my grandsons, everybody, everything. You know, as I was looking yesterday, and I repeat what I just mentioned this morning, when we gave the food to this first person, and I saw the face of this guy, you know, I just couldn't believe how much he was enjoying that. And he was enjoying the fruit of quite a few of us, you know, once cooked, another did this, another did that, and he would never know them. But what we did was for the interest of him. And he was a little bit off already, you know. He said, he couldn't even talk, you know. He was funny with us. after he received the thing, you know, he said, thank you very much. And I could see in his face, he says, why didn't you leave so I could eat it? He didn't want to hear anything. But anyway, and that is a thing that we have to recognize. He is the way, and the way that I'm going to walk in that way of life cannot be done unless I learn about him, because here I go. God is love, and he who doesn't love doesn't know God, etc., etc. And I got this. It's so easy to say it, right? It's so easy to memorize it. At least for some people, to memorize it's very easy. But when you sit down and you look at the love of God for me, and I begin to understand what he was trying to tell me, I really make me think twice. Do I really want to embark on this thing called Christianity? Because for what I understand is that I'm going to be a zero to the left. Nobody. You know, it's a... Before you came, you wanted to be a zero to the right all the time. But when you become one more, it's called denying yourself for the benefit of the world. And that, in the world of today, in the world of yesterday, in the world of always, is not a common thing or a desirable thing for the people of the world. In verse 5 it says, in your relationship with one another, have the same mind as Christ Jesus. Have the same mind as Christ Jesus. And then you have it in verse 6, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equal to being like God, or to be like God, as something to use for his own advantage. Yeah. Jesus Christ is the example. That's why I love that verse in John, first chapter of John, when those two disciples, the first two disciples, that they just left John the Baptist, and he said those famous two words, come and see. Come and see what this is about. Because he's saying here in that verse 5, that this is, I'm going to show you a way for life that you don't know. Not only that you don't know, Carlos, it will be impossible for you to do it without me. I'm going to emphasize that this afternoon. It would be impossible for me to do it. Because that not only the Word of God says it in John 15:5, but the reality is that I can see that there are so many things that I cannot do. But one thing that I have learned in the things that I cannot do is this: to be still. And here again, to be still, knowing my power and the power of God. To be still spiritually is different than to be still physically. You can be walking, and you can be very active in the church, and you can be still in God. That's the beauty of Christianity. Christianity teaches you a way of life that you never, you always thought it was different because you were taught, at least I was taught as a child, you know, that religion was the thing, and light the candles, and we had talked about this all the time, you know. But I wasn't learning how to have a relationship not only with God but with nobody. But now I come to this. And I can start to comprehend that the purpose of God in my life is to glorify his name for what he produces through me. It's not what I do, it's what He produces in me. I was talking to my wife the other night, and we were making a decision about something we have to do. And I said to her, you know, I know that you want that, and I understand. But I don't see any of it for that person. This person has to learn it, to trust God, not to trust us. Listen to me. I know that if a child is coming running and stumbles and strains his knees and start crying, I'm going to help that child. I know what he needs. He needs that somebody comes and say, oh, poor thing, you know, and you go and put a little bit of water and then put a little something there and you kind of counsel him. You know, but I also have learned not to get involved in the business of God when God is dealing with somebody. When somebody is going through some problem, that's why I ask the Lord all the time, Lord, give me discernment. Don't allow Carlos to start thinking that he knows what this is about. Give me discernment. Because sometimes you see a brother or a sister going through a difficult situation and your tendency is to immediately come and try to pull that person out, and God has got that person there. And God is teaching that person to be there and to wait there. I know that I can prove that in the Bible by the book of Job. You know, I don't have to go too far. Because these two people, you know, these friends are coming to tell Job. Job, they thought that they were helping Job. And they are suggesting to him what he has to do to get out of that situation. And they made things worse. God was teaching this man the most important thing in everybody's life. God was teaching this man to have a real relationship with Him. Through everything that he took away from him, he was teaching this man. He was a good man. To come to the realization who God is and how we have to have that relationship with him. This chapter 2 of the book of Philippians is one of my favorite chapters in the Bible, because it kind of gives you the example that Paul is teaching that, and he is giving you the example of what Jesus did. As you know, we're not going to be able to go through the whole chapter, but what I'm saying, I'm going to kind of make it short. He said, one of the verses said, that Jesus, being in the form of God, didn't take that in consideration to go to the cross, to die for me. And because yesterday we did what we did, and to think that God, Jesus Christ, died for those people too. God loves those people the same way that He loves me. God doesn't make any exception of person. I had to call the attention to somebody, not to go back here in the church. You know, in the Spanish congregation, I had to call the attention to that person. That the way that this person was talking was not the proper way. I said, you are showing me that what is in your heart, and what is in your heart is not of God. Because the way that you express yourself about those people is not of God. And I cannot allow being the in charge of that, I said, for you to get away with that. And I would appreciate that anybody, Pastor Hector, anybody here, and you see me doing something wrong, bring it wrong. And he said, hey, I said, well, just look at me, and he said, God, I was just like, no, I would like that you come and say, listen, what you just did is wrong. Now, you don't come in a Bible way of trying to humiliate me. You come in love, too. But we have to correct one another. Pastor Hector and Pastor Bobby probably wanted most here because they've been in ministry for quite a while now. Know how difficult it is to minister sometimes. In reality, sometimes it's beyond you. You really have to sometimes back away and allow God to take over in such a way that you just wait there in faith. But tonight, what I wanted to say to you is this. In verse 1, he said the being like-minded. This is the thing that I pray for my congregation, where the Lord put me. The Lord put me in this season of my life in the somebody Foursquare Church. I came, like I mentioned yesterday and I mentioned this morning, and I was very surprised because I never had contact with Filipino people in my life. It was another culture that I never had contact with. And I had to start observing, not with the entry and with the intention to criticize or anything. I really had to start watching with the intent to learn. To learn how you people and how the Filipino parents treat their daughters and sons. I never seen it before. I know that we parents love our sons and daughters and granddaughters, etc. But I never seen a culture treating the little ones the way that the Filipino treat the little ones. Because I started watching the night. I was one day sitting in my place there, and I was watching the teenagers of this church treating the little ones of this church. And I was crying. I said, God. They pick him up and go and play outside with them. This is not the way I want it. I'm accustomed. Because the Latino society is different. Especially in the men, in the teenagers. I don't know what it is, that they become very cruel at that age. They become very hostile, you know. And I have seen, I'm not pleased, I have seen how brothers treat sisters in the I don't say anybody, but I say a lot of people in the Latino culture mistreat their sisters. And I wasn't. And then I started observing other things. And one day I was talking to Pastor Sardin, God bless his soul. And I said to him, God brought me here, brother. He said, what's the you? Because he wanted me to go with him. I said, no, God brought me here. And I cannot go with you. I'm here because God brought me here. And I love you and everything, you know. But I'm going to stay here because that's what God wants me to be. And it was a season for me to sit in there and be quiet and observe. With the intent of learning, not with the intent of criticizing. How you watch things going by your life is very important that you learn as you meditate in the Word of God, because the Word of God tells me that having eyes I didn't see, and then having ears I didn't hear. So I have to apply every day in my life to be very careful not to allow the human nature of Carlos, the old Carlos, how I'm looking at things, how I'm analyzing things. I cannot afford that. don't know about you. And it's not that I'm trying to be goody-goody to shoes, because that's not my nature either. You know, my point is that I wanted to do what this is saying. I want to see things in the proper perspective of Christ, of proper perspective of the body of Christ. For every action that I take is going to have a reaction based on for yourself. Everything that you do here has effects in everybody. Even if we don't know it. If I go tonight and I do something wrong, because of the fact that I'm member of this body, will give promise to this congregation. That's why I have to become responsible for my actions. That's why I have to constantly be in prayer, asking God for help to solve the situations of my life, whatever they are. Because I know that I'm responsible before Mary. Everything that I do is going to affect him, whether he realizes it or not, that's the way it is. How I learned that? Go to chapter 6 of the book of Nathan. The book of Joshua. And you see a man that nobody saw stealing. The Babylonian mantle and the coins of silver. Nobody saw him. Right? Nobody saw him. He took him to his tent and he hid him. He hid him the things. And then the whole people of Israel, the whole nation was defeated in the next battle. The whole nation. And when you see Yahshua coming to the Lord and asking, I'm confused. I don't understand why this happened, because you brought us here. We just had a big victory in Jericho. What's going on? That city is just a little bad thing. You know, we can take what. And God showed him that without him, they couldn't do nothing. And then he said the famous verse to this Yahshua. Says, Israel has sinned. He didn't say, they can sin. But he said, Israel has sinned. I remember I read that and I started studying that and I started meditating. I said, my God, you know, I have to be careful how I have to react. For God sees everything that I do. Not only what I do, God sees everything that I think. And so, let's, you know, I really have this in my heart. I think this, I still believe it's going to be an incredible explosion in this church.
Oh, yeah.
But I think that God is waiting for us. See, we are waiting upon God, right? But I think that God is waiting for us. I think that God is waiting for some of us to say, wait a minute, I have to correct this. I have to correct that. I have 3 people in this congregation in prayer every day. Asking the Lord to touch them in such a way that they can become part of the body. They are here every Sunday, and I ask God to incorporate them in the body, in the flow of the blood. I like that. I like to see, not to criticize. I like to see and to watch, to see what I can do without saying anything. And when I say without saying anything, it's without allowing Carlos to put his nose into it. No. I go and I ask God, God, show me how I can help these people. And then usually the answer is, meditate in my word and I will reveal it to you. Now hear the analysis. That's what I love to teach. God is not going to show me. God is going to reveal me, reveal things to me. When he reveals, it becomes so incredibly real. You can see it so well. And you can see it so well, putting away your opinion and your perspective, because it's God who is showing it to you, the way it really is. Human perspective is very dangerous when you don't apply it the right way. So I really believe that although we are together, Paul explained the anatomy of the body of Christ using my body or our body, because my eye doesn't look like my arm. It's very simple, that teaching of Paul. I now in my eyes don't look like my arm. I know that my eyes are vital for my body. And I have the tendency to believe that my eyes are more important than my arms. But this isn't so. They are all important. They are all important because without my arms, I cannot grab anything, I can do, I'll do a lot of things, of course. I cannot afford to lose a member of my body. I'm going to say this about one member, and I'm going to mention his name because I know he knows that I'm going to use it. There's a member here in the church that lost a couple of toes of his right foot because of diabetes. He is not paralyzed. But when you see my brother Mark walking, you can see that he doesn't work, if you want to call it normal. He kind of limps. Because two little toes are missing on his foot. He cannot keep the balance like a person that's got everything there. And then he tells me all the problems that he's got with that leg because the absence of those two toes. And he was telling me, I said, you got to be kidding me. And he was telling me all the things that this leg of his gets so incredibly full of pain because he gets so tired of that leg because those two toes are missing. Isn't that a subject? But he can walk. Now, what I'm trying to say with that is this, that everybody has a function. And although we can walk, we might not be walking the way that God wants us to walk. So tonight, like Ben said last night, last week, they promised me that if I preach short, I'll be invited again. I think that's what's funny. I just want that we go to rest, the rest of the Sunday, with a good feeling that we belong in the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. Have no doubt that you are in the right place. It doesn't have to be a huge congregation. Mm. I've been there, and I felt lonely. Yeah, nobody knew my name. What kind of thing is that? But I've been in a little church in South America where it was just a little room with a light hanging in the middle of the little place, and it had a metal roof. The benches were made out of, had no floor, it was just dirt. And they were about 15 people. And they were praising the Lord with all their heart. And I was teaching there with all my heart. And I enjoyed that as much as if I would have been in a big stadium, like Billy Graham. You know what I'm saying? Because I love the body of Christ. I did not agree with it. Nobody called me to for my opinion. You see? That's the thing. I just have to allow the mind of Christ to always operate my behavior, my way of doing things. So tonight, let's pray for that. Let's pray that we come to understand how important is each one of us here in this body. How necessary is that we learn to function in the proper way. I'm not indicting anybody that is walking wrong. What I'm saying is that I know that I can improve my walk. God is always perfecting me. He's adding things to us. He's making us strong. He's making us wiser. And if we learn to depend upon Him and everything, it will be glorious. It will not be easy, but it will be glorious. May God bless you, people.